this already happened in some sense. It's like it's no, there's no question that this Silicon Valley, the men of Silicon Valley, I call them, they are the new elite. There are some women too, but not enough. So in fact, I think we do them a lot of good to include more women. But for now, it's mostly men. And look at these people. I mean, look, with love and respect. But come on, I mean, look at this. Just this one thing comes to mind. Mark Anderson, one of the top investors in Silicon Valley. The debacle with his tweets about India and about Facebook's offering free internet to India, but with a caveat that they would be controlling which websites would be accessible through that internet. And India, to their credit, the government refusing that offer. And then Anderson, who is a prolific Twitterer, goes and tweets that, oh, these people are so stupid not to do it. They criticized colonialism and now they're criticizing Facebook. You see, so he actually makes the link himself. So that's the height of hubris. That's the height of ignorance, the height of arrogance. But in a sense, it's helping us because he then gives away the secret that everybody knows, that yes, it is colonialism. That is a new form of colonialism. And we are being colonized, not in India, but everywhere in the world. We are being colonized by these technology companies, which operate with very little oversight, which have tremendous power, which have time and again have colluded with the government. There are exceptions, of course, but unfortunately, it's more of a becoming more and more a default. And again, you know, I have no doubt in personal integrity of any of the founders. But let me give you just one example. You know, when Google was founded, what was their motto? What was their slogan? Don't do evil. Well, guess what? A year ago, they changed the name of the company to Alphabet, and they changed their slogan. It now is, do the right thing. To which I'd like to ask, the right thing for whom? The right thing for whom? So it's not anymore, don't do evil. You know, when Google acquired DeepMind 2 years ago, they promised the creation of an ethics board to tackle questions of artificial intelligence. 2 years later, there is no information about this ethics board. In fact, I just to be sure, I Googled it again. I Googled Google ethics board. There is no information. The latest is that Demis Hassabis was saying that he wanted to create it. 2 years later, after they having promised. Now, I give him personally a lot of credit for, in fact, it appears that it was his personal initiative to insist on creating such a body when the company was acquired by Google. So I have no doubt in his good intentions, nor do I have any doubts in personal, you know, good intentions of other founders, of other companies I have mentioned. However, it's very telling that 2 years later, there's no board, there's no transparency, there's no information, there's no oversight. So what it starts to look like more and more is, as a great author, you know, Paulo Coelho said, the Nobel Prize winner, boys with toys, you know, boys with toys, but these are dangerous toys. It's like a child in the supermarket who finds a handgun in his mother's purse without safety on it, you see. So that's where we are. And unfortunately, I don't hear so much discussion of this. I don't hear so many people asking why there is not enough oversight. So yes, it is a new elite. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, because obviously, you know, the men in our government haven't done much better, but at least they're elected. And you can talk about the flaws, the obvious, glaring flaws of the electoral process, but at least there is an electoral process. In the case of companies like Google and Facebook, we have multinational huge multinational corporations which are controlling bigger and bigger parts of our lives, which are themselves controlled by a very small number of people who are not beholden to anybody except their shareholders. Now, if somebody thinks that this is not a recipe for disaster, I think they should think again. Yeah, very serious issue. I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to speak to the Turkish audience. I have visited Turkey several times, and it's one of my favorite countries in the world. I really enjoy the culture, the history, the food, the people, famous Turkish hospitality, and really had some amazing times in especially in Istanbul, but in other places as well. And I think Turkey is one of the most important countries in the world today, because Turkey is right in the middle of all the conflicts, sort of all the axes of power, of conflicts, go through Turkey today. And that means it's not so easy for Turkish people, but it puts a lot of responsibility on Turkey, I think, in the world. It has a lot of, I think Turkey will play a bigger and bigger role in the next few decades. And so I think my sense from visiting Turkey, and I was there just a few months ago, is that a lot of people are aware of this. And that I find very heartening, especially young people, so full of energy, so full of life, so inquisitive, so curious about everything, and looking for new ideas. This is what we need. We need new ideas. We should not allow dogmas and prejudice and sectarian separation, especially, to dominate our lives the way they have been dominating us for so long. We cannot afford that anymore. And I think that I feel like Turkish people are sort of like the avant-garde, kind of like in the front. In the rows of that change that we desperately need today in our world to survive. So I hope you enjoy this interview, and I look forward to the continuation of the dialogue.